It's my pleasure to introduce the presenter's Nesbitt lecturer, Dr. Louise Requena. Now, Dr. Requena is known to all dermatologists across the world, and he knows more about panniculitis than anybody else in the world, but obviously his expertise is not limited to that. He's one of the most prolific publishers in dermatopathology with more than 1,000 papers in dermatology and dermatology. He has done more than 100 book chapters in recent times, several textbooks of excellent quality. Professionally, he is the chair and the professor of dermatology at the Universidad Autónoma in Madrid, Spain. And being from Madrid, as you can expect, he is a fan of football and an ardent supporter of Real Madrid. And he has memories about Liverpool and its football background. So I'm sure you'll be sharing some of the anecdotes in today's lecture. But it is a pleasure to welcome you today. And he's going to speak today on paraprotein deposits in the skin. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your nice words. It's really an honor and a privilege to be here giving this lecture about Neil Smith. I knew Neil Smith. I remember very well when I was a resident of the second year in my hospital. He visited us, and it was very impressive for me because he was not just a super dermatopathologist. He was an incredible clinician. I remember we have, in that time, in the hospital about 40 beds with very difficult patients inside in Hospital 12 de Octubre of Madrid. And he was right with everyone. So he passed very quickly and did the diagnosis of all patients, all of them right. So impressive, not just dermatopathology, also very good clinician. So it's really an honor for me to give a lecture for him. And I am very happy to be here because, as Axo said, I hit Barca. So I am supporting Real Madrid, and this year the Reds saved me. So I am very happy with Liverpool team, destroy Barca. So it was a good year for us because if Barca is not the champion, I am happy. So now I am supporting Reds every day. I was really happy with the Liverpool as a champion of the European Champion League. So Neil Smith loves the cartoons. You know him, or you knew him. He was always presenting the histopathology features with nice cartoons. So I dedicate to him the cartoons. This is the shield of Liverpool, and this is the shield of Real Madrid. Now we are brothers in this team because they destroy Barca. So I propose to the president of Real Madrid team to change the logo. So this is the new logo for Real Madrid. You see, we translate to Spanish. I like this, you will never walk alone. In Spanish is nunca caminarás solo. So we have a similar seal now for the Real Madrid, and I love Liverpool. So let's talk about monoclonal gammopathies. I think this is important for dermatologists and for dermatopathologists because sometimes with a cutaneous biopsy, you can make the specific diagnosis of very serious disease. So dermatopathology has a very important role in the diagnosis of this disease. The definition is easy for monoclonal gammopathies are disorders characterized by the clonal proliferation of B lymphocytes in their most advanced maturative state, plasma cell or lymphoplasmacytic cells, and they are producing an immunoglobulin. And the name is a monoclonal immunoglobulin, the name is paraprotein or monoclonal M component. I proposed a new classification for this disease because some people speak about the most common, the less common, the paraneoplastic. From a pathogenic point of view, I think it's important to make the differential diagnosis when the deposition is depending on the clonal process or when the deposition is independent of the clonal process. And in this second group, most of these diseases are paraneoplastic disease, so they are not related with the deposition of the immunoglobulins. Of course, depending on the clonal process, sometimes you have cutaneous involvement by the lymphoproliferative disease. This is a kind of cutaneous metastasis in multiple myeloma and in Waldenström macroglobulinemia. It's curious, but it's rare. So plasma cells doesn't like the skin when they are neoplastic, and I will not cover this process. There are cases of multiple myeloma and Waldenström macroglobulinemia involving the skin, but this is very rare. The important point for dermatologists and dermatopathologists is when you have the position of the monoclonal protein. These are rare processes, but very characteristic, so you can make the specific diagnosis, so I will cover this list of diseases in my presentation. And then, independent of the clonal process, you have paraneoplastic process, so I will not cover this process in my presentation. So I will focus in disease related with the deposition of the monoclonal protein, the M component, in the skin. And it's important also, I think, to distinguish between when the immunoglobulin is intact, so you have the deposition of the immunoglobulin, and when the immunoglobulin is modified. The clinical and histopathologic features are very different. When the entire immunoglobulin, the protein, is deposited in the skin, you have these three processes: nodular macroglobulinosis and Bullous macroglobulinosis. They are similar from pathogenic point of view, but the clinical and histopathologic features are different. But sometimes you don't have the entire immunoglobulin. You have only the deposition of the light chains or the heavy chains. And it's rare, but there are also cases with this kind of deposition in the skin. So let's start with the entire immunoglobulin deposited in the skin. We have cutaneous, from generic name of this, cutaneous macroglobulinosis. And depending on where is the location of the deposition, you have two different processes. When the deposition of the immunoglobulin is in the dermis, you have the so-called nodular macroglobulinosis. And when the deposition is in the interface between the epidermis and the dermis, you have a very curious blistering disease. It's not autoimmune, but very similar to pemphigus, or to pemphigoid, to bullous pemphigoid, because the deposition is in the basal layer of the epidermis, just in the lamina densa, and this is the so-called bullous macroglobulinosis. Both of them are rare, but very characteristic. Nodular macroglobulinosis, I reviewed the literature, and there are only 17 cases reported, and most of the patients, they have Waldenström macroglobulinemia, so it's more or less very specific for that. From clinical point of view, you see this kind of asymptomatic translucent papular lesions that they are involving the extensor areas of the lid and mostly over the bone surface. So when the bone is superficial, in these areas it's like erythema levatum duodenum. This is the predilection place for the deposition of the macroglobulin. This has no prognostic implications, so the prognosis of the Waldenström disease in this patient is not related with the deposition on this macroglobulin. From a histopathologic point of view, it's very characteristic. You see this, I will show you in a minute, nodular eosinophilic hyaline deposition in the dermis, and sometimes you have artifactual cleft, retraction clefts, and with a special stain, with PIS, with direct immunofluorescence, you can demonstrate that the deposition is the immunoglobulin IgM. If you do electron microscope, you see non-fibrillary amorphous organular material. This is the only patient I have seen with cutaneous macroglobulinosis. He has this erythematous papular lesion involving the anterior aspect of the knee, and some of them were eroded and covered by a scaling crust. But the histology is very easy. You see this kind of homogeneous eosinophilic material, so this is not sclerotic collagen. You see the clefts of this, the deposition of the immunoglobulin in the dermis. So you see the biopsy. The diagnosis is only one, cutaneous macroglobulinosis, very characteristic. You can demonstrate by immunohistochemistry, by immunofluorescence, that this is the deposition of the paraprotein. Bullous macroglobulinosis is even more rare. There are only six cases. I have seen only one patient in my department. And again, this is closely related with Waldenström macroglobulinemia. Very typical from clinical point of view, it's very similar to bullous pemphigoid. You see blister, excoriation, papular lesion, and scar. Sometimes the differential diagnosis is porphyria cutanea tarda, involving the acral areas of the skin. And again, this deposition, this bullous macroglobulinosis, has no prognostic implication. From a histopathologic point of view, so epidermal blister with a linear deposition, so very similar to bullous pemphigoid, but here the deposition is IgM. Remember, in bullous pemphigoid and in epidermolysis bullosa is mostly IgG. If you do the cell split skin test, you know, the test technique to separate the epidermis above the lamina lucida from the dermis beneath the lamina lucida, the deposition is in the dermal side. So the antigen here, the deposition is these 290 kilo Dalton's antigen is there in this kind of bullous macroglobulinosis. You see, this is the only patient I have seen in my department. It was 10 years ago. And you see, from clinical point of view, it's very similar to pemphigo. You see blisters, probably not over normal skin. There is an urticarial or erythematous, edematous plaque. And then you have the blister, the crust, the erosions in different states of evolution. The histology is clearly a subepidermal blister, but in contrast with pemphigoid, epidermolysis bullosa, there is no inflammatory infiltrate. So it's similar to porphyria cutanea tarda, but if you pay attention to the blood vessels here, there is not the deposition of these eosinophilic rings or porphyrins, which are characteristic of porphyrias. Here, with hematosylineosin, you only see the subepidermal blister. And if you do the direct immunofluorescence with a Salisbury skin test, you see this in the dermal side. You have a linear deposition of IgN. It's very rare, but very characteristic. Sometimes the deposition is not the entire immunoglobulin, only the late change deposition, and this is rare, but there are cases of late change deposition disease with deposition in the skin. So this is the original description by Randall. Some people use the term Randall disease, and in the half of the cases that they have this kind of manifestation are associated with multiple myeloma. In contrast with macroglobulinosis, was more frequent in patients with Waldenström disease. Here is more frequent with multiple myeloma. But there are cases with light change deposition in the skin, and the patient has no monoclonal gammopathy. Sometimes it's preceding. So you have to follow with the hematology department just to demonstrate the deposition of this light change fragment of immunoglobulin. From prognostic point of view, the skin is not important. The most important is the kidney, the renal disease, because 90% of the cases, they will develop terminal insufficiency and you need renal transplant or hemodialysis. There are also involvement on other areas, but there are more rare. So kidney is very rare. This is a case of Dr. Maite Fernández Figueras. I have no examples from Barcelona. This woman has this kind of nodular lesion involving the chins and also around the nasolabial folds, and the process was slowly growing during the last 10 years. This is the histology. You see this deposition of eosinophilic material. I think for histopathology with conventional hematosylineosin is very similar to amyloidosis. You see this kind of material, sometimes with some clefts between the eosinophilic deposition involving the reticular dermis. Usually the papillary dermis is spurred, and you see this homogeneous eosinophilic deposition in the dermis. So this material is PIS positive, like sometimes amyloid, but when you stain with Congo red, it's negative. So this is completely different. The appearance is very similar, but Congo red is negative. And if you stain with a light chain immunoglobulin, in this particular case, you see the strong positivity for kappa light chain. So this is a monoclonal deposition of the light chains. So if you do electron microscopy, this is granular material, so it's completely different of porphyria, with hematosylin, eosin, of amyloid. With hematosylin, eosin is very difficult to make the differential diagnosis, but you stain with kappa and lambda, is easy, and the ultrastructural appearance of the material is completely different from amyloid, because here, you know, amyloid is sometimes with a filamentous material, and here is more granular. So I think that with a special stain and with electron microscopy, you can make the differential diagnosis between amyloidosis, because the histology is very similar, and light chain deposition disease. And sometimes the deposition is the heavy chain disease. This is very rare, but there are few cases described, four cases, and all of them, from clinical point of view, they have cutis laxa. So when you have the deposition of the heavy chain of the immunoglobulin in the skin, you have this kind of hanging skin involving the folds and involving the face. I have seen another case with this peculiar, this is the sacral cutis laxa, so that the patient touch or press something, there was this kind of depression, and the patient needs hours to recover the normal appearance of the skin, so it's the so-called acral cutis laxa. From a histopathology point of view, when you take a biopsy, hematosylineosin, you don't see anything. It looks like normal skin. So you have to suspect every time that we have the so-called invisible dermatosis, you don't see anything with hematosylineosin. We always stain for elastic tissue, and here you have almost completely destroyed very tiny fragments of elastic tissue. So this is the histopathology of cutis laxa. And if you do immunofluorescence in this material, there are very tiny, but the deposition is there. So there is the deposition of the IgG attached to the elastic tissue. So it's not very dramatic, but if you pay attention, there is this granular, small deposition of IgG attached to the elastic tissue. So this is clearly related with the monoclonal gammopathy of the patient. These are the process with the intact deposition of the immunoglobulin, but sometimes the immunoglobulin is modified. Before the deposition in the skin, you have modified immunoglobulin, and according to the modification, we have three different processes. Sometimes it's beta-folded immunoglobulin. This is typical of amyloidosis. Up to now, there are more than 30 types of amyloid deposition, and the composition is different, 31 types. But from the dermatologic point of view, I think these five are the important. One is the deposition of amyloid A. This is the so-called AA amyloidosis, which is characteristic related with chronic inflammatory disease. There are a very curious amyloidosis also with neurological involvement. We have some families in Spain, and it's very frequent in Portugal. It's clearly is the so-called ATTR amyloidosis, because you have the deposition of amyloid transthyretin in the skin and in the nerves. So the deposition in this kind of amyloidosis is very tiny and it's difficult to demonstrate, but we have now specific antibodies for staining this type of amyloid. So it's familiar amyloidosis with type 1 of polyneuropathy. The important amyloidosis related with these monoclonal gammopathies is AL amyloidosis, just the variable segment, amino-terminal segment, of the light chains of immunoglobulin. And this is clearly related with this kind of myeloproliferative disorders or macroglobulinemia of Waldenström or multiple myeloma. Beta-2 amyloid is related with hemodialysis. Sometimes you have cutaneous manifestation. I have no experience, but there are also a blistering disease related with that. And the most common, by far, amyloidosis in the skin is coming from the keratin. So macular amyloidosis and lichen amyloidosis is the same process in different states of evolution. The amyloid is coming from keratin. So this is not related with monoclonal gammopathies. So the important in this context, in this process, is the deposition of amyloid AL. So it's the variable, the terminal segment, amino terminal segment of the light chains of immunoglobulin. And the typical manifestation are most of these patients, they have systemic amyloidosis, and sometimes the patient is coming with dermatologic manifestation. He has no any other clinical, and it's the dermatologist and the dermatopathologist responsible for the diagnosis. You see macroglossia most of the time, and it's very easy. You see the indentation, the marks of the teeth, and the bilateral borders of the tongue. When the deposition is more intense, then you have this kind of washy papular lesions involving the face, the scalp, and the skin folds. If the deposition is very intense, it's rare, but there is well described the deposition involving the palms, and most of these patients, they have hemorrhagic lesions because the amyloid is deposited in the vessel walls and in areas of lax skin, like around the eyelids, in the axilla, around the neck, you have hemorrhagic lesion. This is very characteristic, and I will show you the histology. This is one of the patients with the typical manifestation. You see the macroglossia and the so-called raccoon signs. You have this kind of hemorrhagic pigmented lesions with induration and with thickening of the skin of eyelids, very characteristic of systemic amyloidosis associated with multiple myeloma. This is another patient on my hospital. Fortunately, she died a few days later of the clinical picture, and you see the hemorrhagic lesions, because when the patient is taking increase of venous pressure, because vomiting, because coughing, because increase the venous pressures, then in the areas of lax skin, around the eyelids, in the axilla, in the skin folds, you have this kind of hemorrhagic lesion. Another patient with multiple myeloma, you see, around the eyelids, and around in the base of the neck, the typical hemorrhagic lesions. And if you take a close view, in the axilla, you can see the washy, small papular lesion, brilliant, the deposition in the groin, very similar, so skin folds on the face are the predilect area of this kind of WASI papular lesions and hemorrhagic lesions in patients with systemic amyloidosis related with multiple myeloma. This is a very dramatic case I saw many years ago with this kind of nodular lesions involving the eyes. Usually it's not so dramatic. The patient has problems to open the eyes because the strong, the heavy deposition of immunoglobulins in the skin of eyelids. And there are also patients with multiple myeloma. You see hemorrhagic lesions when the deposition is very intense in the vessel walls. You can have purpuric or hemorrhagic lesions involving the back and nodular deposition involving the fingertips. The bias is very similar in all these kind of systemic amyloidosis related with multiple myeloma and with paraproteinemia. You see this eosinophilic pink material with some clefts in between, and it's clearly deposited in the vessel walls. Here you see in the right lower corner a small capillary with the deposition of the eosinophilic material in the vessel wall. So this resulting in fragility for this kind of capillaries, and then it's more easy to have hemorrhagic lesion every time that the patient has vomit on or increase the venous pressure. Sometimes you have nodular amyloidosis and the patient is fine. So you study from a hematologic point of view, bone marrow is normal, there is no any cutaneous manifestation, and this is the so-called amyloidoma. In the past, it was called nodular amyloidosis, and now we use the term amyloidoma. You see the eosinophilic nodular deposition in the deep reticular dermis, epidermis is normal, superficial dermis is normal, and the lower half of the dermis, you have again the same material, this eosinophilic pink material with some clefts in between. You stain for Congo red, this is clearly positive, so this is clearly nodular deposition of amyloid. Another case with the same features, so in this particular case, the entire dermis, the collagen is replaced by this material homogeneous with clefting in between. It's also very typical in the subcutaneous tissue. You see this kind of eosinophilic ring, necrotic adipocytes, sometimes the nuclei disappear, and it's a kind of necrotic subcutaneous tissue with these very characteristic eosinophilic rings around these necrotic adipocytes. It's important that you pay attention to the plasma cells. Sometimes there are very few, but sometimes there are clusters of plasma cells. You see with the Russell bodies, so they are producing the immunoglobulin, and the cytoplasm of this plasma cell is eosinophilic homogeneous because this is the immunoglobulin. First, they keep the immunoglobulin and they release, and then you have the amyloid. It's important because if you study from immunohistochemical point of view, in most of these cases, these plasma cells are monotypic, are monoclonal. So just here you see the expression of late chains is completely positive for kappa and completely negative for lambda. So this is the so-called restriction, only expressing late chains. So this is a monoclonal proliferation, it's neoplastic. So for that reason, we have collected 10 cases with Noreen Was and with Lorenzo Cerroni. We published a paper. We study from immunohistochemical point of view. Sometimes plasma cells are very few, but if you stain for plasma cells or you do molecular study for rearrangement of the AGH, so the gene producing the heavy chains of immunoglobulin, these plasma cells are neoplastic. So probably many of these cases of nodular amyloidosis or amyloidoma are just cutaneous marginal B-cell lymphoma with very good prognosis, low-grade lymphoma, but they are really monoclonal. So it's a neoplastic proliferation of plasma cell producing this kind of immunoglobulin. Sometimes the immunoglobulin is precipitated because of the cold. So it's the so-called cryoprecipitate material, and then the clinical manifestation, there are three diseases with this kind of cryoprecipitated immunoglobulin. One is cryoglobulinemic vasculopathy, reactive angioendotheliomatosis. Most of the time you can demonstrate the deposition of the cryoglobulin there, and very characteristic, very specific is the so-called cryokeratotic spicules mostly on the nose. So you know cryoglobulins, we classify a monoclonal when you have one immunoglobulin, monoclonal IgG, or monoclonal IgM, and polyclonal or mixed cryoglobulin, you have two types. Sometimes one is the antibody against the other one. From dermatology and from dermatopathology, and for dermatopathology, it's important to make the differential diagnosis because cutaneous manifestation for monoclonal gammopathy is very specific. You can make the diagnosis of monoclonal gammopathy with the cutaneous biopsy because you see the eosinophilic material occluding the small vessel that I will show you in a minute. In contrast, polyclonal cryoglobulin, most of the time you have leukocytoclastic vasculitis, so the deposition of cryoglobulin is very small, it's difficult to demonstrate, and I think it's not so specific, so you need clinical pathologic correlation and study the blood of the patient. But for monoclonal gammopathy, for monoclonal cryoglobulins, the histology is very characteristic. So type 1 is important. In every textbook said that it's very common in patients with multiple myeloma with paraproteinemia, but if you review a large series, this is probably the largest series of cryoglobulinemia from Mayo Clinic, and this is not the most frequent reason for monoclonal gammopathy. So it's related with more common with infectious disease, but only 6% of the cases are related with monoclonal gammopathies. For dermatologists, the clinical features are very suspected. Libedo reticularis, every time that you see libedo reticularis, you have to suspect the diagnosis. Of course, this is a syndrome, so libedo reticularis has been described in many cutaneous disease. Sometimes, from clinical point of view, looks like leukocytoclastic vasculitis. You see palpable purpura involving the lower list. And most of these patients, they have also associated renal phenomenon, agrocyanosis, and in the deposition is occluding the vessel, especially in winter, in cold weather, then you can have digital ulcers. This is a typical patient with a monoclonal cryoglobulinemia with necrotic lesions in winter time. He has swelling of the fingers, and in one of the fingers you see necrosis of the distal phalanx. You take a biopsy of monoclonal cryoglobulinemia, is very characteristic. You see the eosinophilic involvement of the lumina of the small vessels. These are not thrombi, this is no erythrocyte, so it's homogeneous eosinophilic. You go to higher magnification, this is homogeneous pink material, completely different from the thrombi. So the differential diagnosis is intravascular disseminated coagulopathy, but a higher magnification I think is easy. The inflammatory infiltrate is spurred. Of course, there are a lot of extravasated red cells, but most of the time, inflammatory response is spurred. You do direct immunofluorescence, you can demonstrate that this eosinophilic material, occluding the lumina of the vessels, is immunoglobulin. So it's the immunoglobulin with the cold cryoprecipitate within the lumina of the vessels. We published a patient with generalized libedo reticularis with monoclonal gammopathy and associated with myeloma multiple. Here you see libedo reticularis involving not just the lower limbs, so there are also involving the back, the trunk, all over the body, and again the same features. You see the eosinophilic material involving the small vessels, the entire thickness of the dermis, not just in the superficial dermis, also in the deep dermis, and even in the subcutaneous tissue. You see the small capillaries between the adipocytes with the same occlusion by this eosinophilic material. Usually this material is PIS positive, and if you compare the proteinogram of the patient, the serum immunoglobulins, with the cryoprecipitate, is the same. So in the skin and in the blood. You can demonstrate also by immunohistochemistry. You stain by IgG, this paraffin-embedded and formal fixed material. Still, you can demonstrate the deposition of IgG. It's much better if you have direct immunofluorescence, but even with paraffin material, you still can demonstrate the occlusion of the vessels with this deposition of crystals of IgG. The second process is reactive angioendotheliomatosis. There are many classifications for reactive angioendotheliomatosis. This is a reactive proliferation of endothelial cells secondary to different stimuli. But for me, there are only two types. When the lesion of the proliferation of endothelial cells is within the lumina of the vessel, we have intravascular reactive angioendotheliomatosis. When it's outside of the lumina, it's the extravascular. So the important for in this context is intravascular reactive angioendotheliomatosis, and most of the time you have a glomeruloid pattern. And some people believe that the so-called glomeruloid hemangioma in patients with points is just a reactive angioendotheliomatosis intravascular. Probably the first case describing this kind of reactive proliferation was described by Phil Lebois and Daniel Santa Cruz in a patient with cryoprotein. It's very typical involving the acral skin. So most of the times The lesions are in the acral areas of the fingers, in the tip of the nose, also involving the ear. So acral areas of the skin in this patient has also involvement of the anterior aspect of the knee. You take a biopsy, did you see this kind of intravascular glomeruloid proliferation? So there is a proliferation of endothelial cells. In this particular case of reactive angioedematosis, you know, today we have immunohistochemical markers to distinguish between lymphatic vessels and blood vessels. Podoplanin, PROX1, and LIFE1 are specific markers for endothelial or lymphatic vessels. They are negative in the vascular blood vessels. So in this particular process, reactive angioedematosis, the vessels involved are the blood vessels, so lymphatics are spared. You have this kind of intravascular proliferation of endothelial cells, including the lumina, and if you pay attention, you can see the eosinophilic material. Sometimes, even with hematoxylin eosin, without any specific stain, there is the deposition of this material in the cytoplasm of endothelial cells. So probably this is common for all these kind of glomeruloid lesions. So Chris Fletcher and Juan Rosai describe glomeruloid hemangioma in patients with Pohen disease, but probably this is the same, the so-called intravascular reactive angioendotheliomatosis. So every time that you have the deposition of immunoglobulins within the cytoplasm of endothelial cells, then you have this non-specific proliferation of glomeruloid with glomeruloid patterns. So if this is true, glomeruloid hemangioma is not hemangioma, it's probably also a reactive intravascular angioendotheliomatosis. Very characteristic, very rare, but you can make the specific diagnosis when you see this kind of clinical features. I think only dermatologists can make the diagnosis of multiple myeloma with cryoglobulinemia looking the nose of a patient. No? There are more than 10 cases. We published this paper many years ago and reviewed the literature. There are now about 20 cases with these peculiar features. It's very characteristic. So in winter time, this patient was fine in summer, but during the winter time with the cold weather, he developed very quickly this kind of whitish columns on the tip of the nose. So we took the material just to study the immunoglobulins, put the nose in the window, and in 10 minutes, the lesions were, again, so were very fast producing this kind of cryoprecipitate. So you see this, the most easy to see are at the tip of the nose, but they involve the entire face. And you take the hairs, this material, so this is not dandruff, this is the immunoglobulin attached to the hair sac. The histology is very characteristic. You see much better when you stain with Mason or with no red stain because the material is red. If you stain with hematoxylin eosin, it's more difficult. But if you stain, for example, with Mason trichromic, you see this perikeratinocytic, so around the cells, and it's very curious because the deposition is much more evident in the inner side of the hair follicle. So in the inner side of the infundibulum and in the isthmus, in this area, you see this eosinophilic material, sometimes with globular appearance, in between the keratinocytes. It's a kind of pemphigus-like deposition around the keratinocytes, very characteristic. So if you do electron microscope, you see this is some people compare this morphology with the colon, with the large intestine, because there are the dermosomes are spurred, so the keratinocytes remain attached, but then the deposition in the intercellular space separates the keratinocytes, and you have this the so-called Austra pattern, like in the colon. This is very characteristic from electron microscopic point of view. If you do direct immunofluorescence, of course it's positive, but this is not autoimmune. So it's a deposition of the immunoglobulin, and you can stain by direct immunofluorescence with this pemphigus-like pattern around the keratinocytes. Mostly, the best place to look for that is in the infundibulum of the hair follicle. After the diagnosis, the patient has a multiple myeloma, poorly symptomatic, but the bone marrow was positive. The patient has small osteolytic lesions involving the skull and also some depression of one of the vertebra. And this is the proteinogram with the typical monoclonal peak of multiple myeloma. We compare the serum of the patient with the material of the speculum. So with we take out the material, just scratching with a molluscum spoon, and we put and we did electrophoresis, and you can see here that the material in the serum of the patient with the material of the speculum is identical. So the monoclonal gammopathy of the patient, so the deposition is the monoclonal gammopathy involving the infundibulin, identical to the serum of the patient. And this is immunoelectrophoresis. Again, the same. You see the monoclonal peak evolving in the serum of the patient. The same material is composing the spicules of the nose. So it's very characteristic. It's very rare, but if you see a patient with this kind of lesions, the diagnosis is multiple myeloma with cryoglobulinemia. So it's not so bad to make the diagnosis of multiple myeloma looking at the nose. And why it is more evident in the nose? So we did different course with according to the pH. So for the deposition of the cryoglobulin, it's not just the cold. So every time that the pH is going more acid, the deposition is more easy. In the skin, if you study the pH of different areas of the face, the more acid area is the nose, because you got sebaceous secretion. So the deposition is on the forehead, on the chin, on the cheek, but it's more evident in the tip of the nose because here the pH is more acid, and then the deposition of the cryoglobulin is more easy. For that reason, it's more evident in the tint of the nose than in other areas of the face. And finally, sometimes you have crystals of immunoglobulin. This is a very serious and very poor prognosis with this kind of patients. The so-called crystal globulinemia vasculopathy is very, the prognosis is very poor. It's very rare, so it's a rare manifestation of monoclonal gammopathy, but you have embolism with the crystals of immunoglobulin in the lumina of the blood vessel. Most of the time, the course is fulminant. But we have seen patients in Salamanca with Dr. Ángel Santos Brid that the course was chronic, so we need several years to make the specific diagnosis, and finally we did. So this is the patient in 1997. He has purpuric lesions we thought that were vasculitis with some necrosis. We took the biopsy and we saw some thrombi in the lumina, but nothing specific. So we thought that the patient has some kind of vasculitis. Here you see, several years later, the lesion was growing. We had to cut several toes of the foot because necrotic lesions. And you see now that the lesions are not just involving the acral areas of the limbs, also involving the buttocks of the lower back. Here you see the necrotic lesions involving the foot. And this is we have several biopsies of this patient, so it's not very easy to see the crystals. But finally, we identify the crystal. Here you see the thrombi, so there is coagulation of the blood, but you can see this very characteristic elongated material. So these are the crystals of immunoglobulin. Crystals are occluding the lumina because around the crystals you have the thrombi, and then you have the occlusion of the blood vessels. So when you see this, then it's more easy to see the material, and you stain for immunoglobulin, these are crystals of the monoclonal gammopathy of the patient. You see here the IgG, and you study by light chance, kappa was strongly positive, was the monoclonal gammopathy, and lambda is negative. So you can demonstrate in the skin that these are crystals of immunoglobulin occluding the lumina of the vessel. So it's a very serious, very poor prognosis. Sometimes you have the deposition of the crystals in the skin. I have no cases of that, but Eduardo Calonge gave me this case that he published with Wilson Jones many years ago with interstitial deposition of the crystals in a patient with multiple myeloma. According to the information that Eduardo gave me, the patient had eyelid edema, so the diagnosis was angioedema for a long time. At the very beginning, the patient was responding to antihistaminic and corticosteroids, but one day, this kind of eyelid edema was fixed. So they took the biopsy, and this is the section that Eduardo gave me. You see the crystals inside of the cytoplasm of the histiocyte, but also interstitial. So in between the collagen bundles, you see this kind of deposition. Very similar to that is the so-called crystal storing histiocytosis. This is clearly related with mostly with different types of lymphomas or different types of paraproteinemia, clearly related with that. So I have a patient with hepatitis C, and he was receiving this kind of treatment. He has also previous history of marginal zone splenic lymphoma with bone marrow infiltration, and he has IgM kappa paraprotein. And she developed erythematous plaque involving the abdominal skin. So from clinical point of view, we thought that this was erysipela or some kind of cellulitis, and the histology was very characteristic. So you see that in the deep dermis and in the subcutaneous tissue, around the vessels, around the eccrine coils, you see these histiocytes with a lot of crystals in the cytoplasm. This is the so-called crystal storing histiocytosis. The same in the subcutaneous tissue. Between the adipocytes, you see the histiocytes with these kind of crystals, very refractile, inside of the cytoplasm. So I think it's important. These kind of cutaneous manifestations are rare, but are very specific. So if you have cases with that, sometimes this is the first manifestation. And for that reason, it's important for dermatologists and for dermatopathologists to know this process, because the patient has no any clinical manifestation of the lymphoma or the paraproteinemia or the myeloma, and you can make the diagnosis with a cutaneous biopsy and with a cutaneous lesion. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Luis, for that very comprehensive review of a subject which I think very few of us have much experience with, whether you're a clinician or a dermatopathologist. It's something very rare, and it's very difficult to, you know, get a good feel of, you know, and for, thanks for sharing your years experience on this. So as is tradition with the joint BAD-BSD lectures, so we'll be happy to give you the Neil Smith lecture and the honorary membership for the BSD. So I'll just come over to you.